life. What is it that makes our lives so valuable? Is it the possibilities? The potential? Giving and experiencing love? Knowing and being known? Learning? Discovering? Struggling and overcoming? Hoping and believing? Is it the joy of what could be or what is? Or the memories of a life well lived? Do we find the meaning in our pain, our hardship or struggle, our fight to survive? What gives our lives value? It's that life itself is sacred. Being human, made in the image of God. You see, it's not about all the good things we might experience or all the potential we may have. It's not simply what you bring to the world or what you can do for me. It's that you bring to the world you. It's the value you bring simply by being alive. You. Yup, you. You are worth it. You are beautiful, precious, absolutely amazing, just as you are. You see, we stand for life because we affirm the importance of life itself. It's the acknowledgement that because of its intrinsic value, we must do everything we can to ensure that it goes on. Not because it will be perfect, but because it will just be. It's a love letter to being human. A letter saying every life is worth it, no matter what. A letter saying life has value, simply because it is.
Good morning. As you can see, I took a morning off from the worship team, and it was nice just to be down here and get things stuck in my pocket. There we go. And just worship with everybody else. The team does such a good job, and it's just nice. Just not that I really needed it, but just more that I wanted to do that. So it looks like we have some people that are going to be probably at the Rexton campus, going to be there for the potluck, and so maybe we should call that pot bless instead of pot luck. You know, do we believe in luck or what? So anyway, we'll get to see them over there. At least I will. So this morning, before I get into my message, I came across a funny. Okay, I'll just let it speak for itself. Frosty gets caught picking his nose, playing words. You guys didn't laugh. Like, when I saw it, I just screamed. I just thought it was hilarious. All right, so okay. So before I get into my message, I want to introduce our 2022 theme, which is four. You see, we have a banner over here, and it's four. And you may be thinking, four, huh? For what? You know, and that might be thoughts that come to your mind. And the thinking is, and it's pretty simple, as I was mulling over the ideas, Kathy and I were talking about this, and we'd be driving someplace, and she'd be coming up with ideas, and we'd be talking and looking at, this one came up early on, and it just kind of stuck. You know, it just stuck there with me. Four. What are we for? You know, and so I just kept thinking about it, and it came to me, and I decided, you know, we need to stay with this. And here's the deal. I believe as a culture, that culture has set the narrative on what Christians, meaning followers of Jesus, have to say about cultural topics. And in their conversations, they say that followers of Jesus, Christians, are against. They're against this. We're against abortion. We're against homosexuality. We're against same-sex marriage. We're against blah. We're against it. We're against. And they just tell the world what we're against. And those people are against this, and they're against that. You know, and using the negative connotations for us. So my thinking is, we have allowed, number one, we have allowed and even fueled the narrative. We've come out emphatically stating that we're against this. We're against that. We've bombed abortion clinics, you know. We've been loud and vocal, and when we're against our government, the way they act when they send COVID people to our nursing homes and stuff. And I get that, and we're not liking that, but we need to start saying we're for. What are we for? So change the narrative is what I'm saying. Instead of saying what we're opposed to, tell people what we're for. And of course, when you tell people we're for this, then we have to tell them why. We have to tell them why we're for that. We just can't leave them hang. And when we say, well, why are you for that? And we start explaining that, we explain and give them the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ in the process. So we just stop, you know, we just stop saying we're against this and against this and start looking at, no, I'm in favor of one man, one woman in marriage. I'm in favor, I'm for healthy families. You look at our poster there, you see, we're for healthy marriages, we're for second chances, we're for creation, we're for reconciliation, we're for stewardship, we're for salvation. Doesn't that sound like a lot better than saying we're against? And we're the negative, bombarding the world with all this negative stuff? You know, we sing the song, The Blessing. And we get to the part in the bridge when we say what that says of God, He is for you. And that moves me. We get to that part in the bridge when we start singing, He is for you. And now that part is sung over and over several times. And I know some people don't like the repetition in those songs. I do. I do, because I believe it goes from just being a song to getting into your spirit and starting to change you. You know, I'm glad to hear that God is for me. And we need to hear that. And we need to sing it to get it into our spirit, not just our brains. People, God is for you. Do you understand that? God is for you. God loves you. Your life has meaning. Your life has purpose. Your life has value. You are valuable. I think people need to hear that. And you need to hear that from me and from us here at CFC. So this year, I'm going to bring messages to help us understand what God is for, meaning that we are for these things. So today, Sanctity of Life Sunday, we'll be looking at for life. We are for life. The idea of sanctity of life obviously comes out of the Roe versus Wade decision, which legalized abortion and got people all up in arms. In my mind, that's a funny phrase, all up in arms. But anyway, rightfully so. We should be disturbed by this. We should have a problem with abortion. We really need to do that. You know, understand that when we say sanctity of life, though, we mean all of life, not just for the unborn. According to the FBI, there were 21,570 murders in 2020, homicides. As of 2019, suicide is a 10th leading cause of death in the U.S. When you're for life, that bothers you. Last month in The Atlantic, they published an article with the headline and byline. Here it is, The Last Children of Down Syndrome. Byline is, prenatal testing is changing who gets born and who doesn't. This is just the beginning. That was byline in The Atlantic last month. So, why are we for life? Understand that we're made in the image of God. And to understand this, we have to go back. So let's go back, Genesis. God said, let us make man in our image according to our likeness. Now, I just highlighted those to show you that, I'm going to take a sidestep here, that the Trinity existed back in the beginning of all times. Let us, our. So if you wonder where Jesus was, you wonder where the Holy Spirit was, they were there in creation, working all things out. So let us make man in our image according to our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the sky, and over the cattle. That means we get to hunt and fish, right? Okay. And then he says, and over all the earth and every creeping thing that creeps on the earth, God created man in his own image, and in the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. So it's up to God. God created us. Life is God's idea. Was it just a good idea? It's a God idea. The Creator brought us into the world in His image, and for the simple fact that you and I have been created in God's image, that makes my life, and that makes your life, and that makes the lives of people out there sacred. They are sacred lives. According to the CDC in 2019, there were 629,898 abortions performed and reported. In 2020, Planned Parenthood reported 354,871 abortions, according to their annual report. Using the CDC's numbers, that comes to 1,726 abortions per day, just in America. That's not worldwide. So before the end of this day, there's going to be over 1,700 deaths. In 2 days, with abortion alone, we have met the number, well, 2.5 days, met the number of the people killed at the World Trade Center. We got really upset about that. That somebody killed 3,500 people. But it happens every 2.5 days in America. We get really upset about the deaths of COVID, right? We should, I get that. But over 600,000 deaths annually because of abortion, and people don't even give it a thought. We've dehumanized the child. This just tells me that we don't value life in America. We say we do, people say they do, but I don't think we really do. We understand that life is sacred because God is the giver of all life, and that life is to be highly valued by everyone because the life has been given to every human is, as broken as we may be, we are all. Yes, the people that you have trouble with, the people you struggle with, we are all made in the image of God. See, life is not a political issue. Yeah, we made it a political issue. We've allowed it to be a political issue. As some like to think, life is a political issue, but it's really a biblical issue. And the power to determine the value and sacredness and the sanctity of life doesn't lie in the throne at Washington, D.C., but it lies in the throne of heaven that God alone is the one sitting on. That's where the power to determine the life lies. I felt a need, you know, this may be a rabbit trail, but I felt a need to cover this. It's just a great passage, and today it's probably being used all over the world, but it needs to be brought out again. Psalm 139, you formed my inward parts. You wove me in my mother's womb. I will give thanks to you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, and my soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the depths of the earth. Your eyes have seen my unformed substance, and in your book were written all the days that were ordained for me. Get that? In your book were written all the days that were ordained for me, when as yet there was not one of them. Before you existed, God had your days laid out for you. This is just one of the many, many Bible passages that show us that life isn't just the product of a biological process that takes place in the body. No, the processes that take place in the womb, they're from God. They're God's handiwork. They're God at work in us. And because of this, we understand that life, whether it be 2 minutes old in the womb, or 20-year-old in college, or an 82-year-old is sacred because God is the giver of life. Man does not have the authority to determine when life begins or when life should end. God does. Now, I want us to think about this idea today. If we as followers of Jesus are going to be for life, as we should, based on God's word, then we need to make sure that we are seeing it through completely. It's real easy to say that we're pro-life, meaning that we're anti-abortion, and that's it. But if we're going to be pro-life, if we're going to be for the sanctity of life, then we need to be people who have a biblical worldview of it, instead of people who have a cultural worldview or even a Christian worldview of it. Some people say, I've got a Christian worldview, and it's really not a biblical worldview at all. So we need to value things and look at things from the Bible's point of view, that we value life inside and outside the womb. We saw a video clips of the for the movie coming up next week, how they started the group Free Burma Rangers. And the fact that there are people who are being abused and killed and murdered all for public power and stuff moved a man so much to start this. And he cared for the lives that he didn't know of these people, but God called him to care for those lives, and he does it. The sermon video before, the intro of the sermon, the video showed all about life and unborn life. But there's other people who have been born, and how do we treat them? How do we care for them? Here's a video clip I want you to take a look at.
I was born in Melbourne, Australia, 1982, and my parents had no idea that I was going to be born without arms or legs. I was the only one that I ever saw without limbs. My faith in Jesus Christ was sealed after 7 years of wondering why, God, I was born this way. He answered me very clearly through John chapter 9. And I gave my life to Jesus at 15 after reading about how he came across a man who was born blind. And I'm like, hey, hold on a second. This looks interesting. And no one knew why he was born that way. I'm like, perfect. So I read on, and in verse 3 of the 9th chapter, Jesus said, it was done so that the works of God would be revealed through him. And I'm like, wow, God, if you had a plan for the blind man, you do have a plan for me. And that was the beginning of my personal relationship with Jesus. Youth groups were starting to call me, churches were starting to call me, opportunities were opening up everywhere for me to share my testimony. I was speaking in front of 300 sophomore public high school students. 3 minutes into it, half the girls were crying. One girl in the middle of the room started weeping. She put up her hand and she said, I'm so sorry to interrupt, but can I come up there and give you a hug? In front of everyone, she came and she hugged me. She cried on my shoulder and whispered in my ear, no one's ever told me that they love me. No one's ever told me that I'm beautiful the way that I am. I couldn't believe it. It changed my life. That was when I knew I was called to be a worldwide evangelist.
Nick Vujicic or something like that, I can't pronounce the name right, but you know, just imagine if his parents would have decided that his life, being no arms and legs, if they've done prenatal testing, found out he's like this, the ultrasound might have told this, I don't know how that works. What would the world be without Nick? Over 500 people have accepted Jesus Christ because of his story around the world. 500,000 people have accepted Jesus Christ because of his story around the world. 500,000, half a million people because of somebody, mom and dad said, no, we're going to bring our son into the world. And maybe they didn't know him, but Jesus knew him. Jesus had a, God had a place for him. He knew his plan before, when he was being knit in his mother's womb. He knew his days beforehand. I need Nick out there to tell the world. So we value life in the womb, outside the womb. We value life American and Afghan, North American, Asian, black and white, rich and poor, educated, uneducated, complete and disabled. We value all of life. I want to take a look at this story. Open your Bibles to Luke chapter 10, if you would, please. One day there was a lawyer came to Jesus, and his plan was to look for a way to get Jesus to publicly contradict the law of Moses so that they could have evidence against them and do away with Jesus. The question he asked was very important. He asked a question about eternal life, but it's obvious that he doesn't understand eternal life. So the question he asked was this: Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? So Jesus answers him and says, how is it, what is written in the law? How do you read it? Notice that it's a typical question about in the Jewish religious beliefs at that time about eternal life is about doing. What shall I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus gives him that straight, simple response. So when Jesus asked him that, I think the lawyer, you know, you got to read into this a little bit. And I think he got a little pious. He got a little bold. He got a little, I know it all. And he answers Jesus. And he says, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. Basically, love God, love others. That's what it comes down to. So Jesus says to him, you've answered correctly. Do this, and you will live. Live out your conviction. You said that this is what it is, so live it out. Now, the lawyer is now, at this point, caught in an awkward moment with tension. Because he has this tension of a determined mind and an unchanged heart. I want you to keep those things in mind. He has a determined mind, but he has an unchanged heart. His mind is set on his beliefs, but his heart, being unchanged, doesn't show the evidence that confirms his beliefs. So he tries to get out of this awkward situation by asking Jesus for some parameters. But wishing to justify himself, he said to Jesus, and who is my neighbor? He wants to get it correct. He wants to get straight just exactly who it is that he should be showing love toward. Who are the people? And let me just tell you that is what religion and religious people do. They want to know what to do, how to do it, and who to do it to so they may be set for eternity. Just give me the ABCs. Just give me the list. I'll go by the list so I can be set. Don't worry about my heart. I have a determined mind, but an unchanged heart. Jesus, in telling the parable, never even answers the question for the lawyer because he's dealing with a deeper issue, and Jesus knew that. So I'm going to paraphrase the rest of this parable. It goes like this. He tells the lawyer and all the people around him a parable. He says, there once was a man traveling, and he got mugged. He got beaten. He got robbed, and he was left laying for dead. Along comes a priest. A priest, seeing the man, travels on the other side of the road because he doesn't want to get close. He doesn't want to become unclean because if he's unclean, he can't do his priestly duties. So he just goes on. A little while later, a Levite comes on. The Levites were the people that helped the priest. And so he sees that, and for the same reason, the priest, he doesn't get close to the man. He walks on the other side of the road and keeps on going. A little while later, there comes another man, a Samaritan. The Samaritans were the people that were ostracized, the people that neither the Jews nor the Gentiles liked because they were a mixed breed of people. They didn't belong to either group. So we don't like those people. And so the Samaritan sees the man and helps him. With what he had, he started cleaning up his wounds, started helping him. He takes him into town, takes him to an inn, bandages his wounds, and he tells the innkeeper, listen, you take care of him. I've got some business to take care of. You watch over him, and when I come back, I'll pay you whatever I need to pay you to make it bill right. He takes care of him. Then Jesus asks the lawyer this question. Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell into the robber's hands? The question wasn't regarding who was the neighbor to be served, but who acted neighborly toward others. Who was the man that acted neighborly? And he said, well, the one who showed mercy toward him. Then Jesus said, go and do the same. The lawyer answered correctly. And Jesus told him, you do it now. Do the same. Now, I don't know what happens with the lawyer. Didn't tell us, but we do know that lawyer had suddenly come face to face with a reality that he would rather not have known. The reality is that just because the person has a determined mind about spiritual and biblical issues does not necessarily mean they have a changed heart. In other words, I can intellectually know this, but I'm not living it out. I don't know for certain, but I suspect that this lawyer went away unchanged and unaffected by the grace that he received that day. The Good Samaritan, for him, the parable represents someone who had experienced a changed heart. the priest and the Levite, their hearts were cold, they're callous toward that person in need, but the Good Samaritan, no, his heart was filled with love and compassion for the man in need. Notice how the religious people went out of their way to look the other way when they saw a need, but the Good Samaritan went out of his way to meet the need when he saw the need. What's the difference between the Good Samaritan and the religious person? It all comes down to the heart. The heart. For us today, the Good Samaritan represents people who've experienced the grace of Jesus in salvation because they have a heart that beats like his does. A heart of compassion for others. So if we are going to be for life, and we are, then is our standing a result of a determined but unsaved mind or the result of a determined and changed heart? It's easy to say that we stand for life. It's easy to say that I'm pro-life, like the lawyer said. He believed the bottom line of life was to love God and love others. But Jesus takes us further to show us that when our stand for life flows from a changed heart, then we don't turn the other way when people created by God in his image, in the image of God, have needs. A true belief in the sanctity of life believes that life should be honored, respected, and valued, whether it's in the womb of his or her mother, or whether it's on the street, Main Street in Nobin Way, or Church Street in Rexton, or US 2 in Mackinac County. So the question is, does your heart beat with a desire to meet the needs because of the value of the life that has them? Or, in all honesty, if we're all going to be honest with ourselves, are we so self-consumed that we are like the religious people in the parable and we turn our heads to avoid seeing the needs of others? And we judge, and we have reasons for not doing this, and we satisfy our lack of interest because with all judgments and assessments of other people. You know, it's hard for the world to take you and me seriously as followers of Jesus who say that we're for life when our beliefs aren't backed by our actions. Tomorrow, Martin Luther King Jr. Day, which honors the life, I believe, of a great man who was out for racial reconciliation. The Bible speaks of the church leading the way in racial reconciliation and equality, and it's only when our hearts have been changed by the gospel that the dividing walls of hostility will be torn down because of a conviction that all lives matter and that we have been created equal in value and sacredness by God in his image. Likewise, when we stand for life, it flows from a determined mind and a changed heart. We'll want to proclaim the gospel. Let people know. When we truly value life like Jesus did, then we'll find that meeting physical needs, while good and necessary, isn't all the end all. Yeah, we'll want to meet needs here, but we need to tell people why we're helping them. Because you matter. You matter. Because Jesus did this in my life. And I want him to do that in your life. And you matter. We have to take the gospel to people who Jesus saw as valuable enough to die for. I want to be clear. In this parable, understand, Jesus is not saying that doing good for others is gaining salvation. You can't be saved by doing good works. He's saying that a determined mind about spiritual matters is worthless if a change of heart hasn't happened in your life because of faith in him for salvation. The Bible teaches that we are saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. That said, when we're saved, when we know Jesus as our Savior and Lord, and we receive a new heart, the Holy Spirit comes in to live in us and changes what happens where our lives look less like they did before and more like Jesus. So today, this day that we're saying we are for life, I challenge you and I encourage you, be praying that God helps you if your heart needs a change. If you have a determined mind, that's great, but you need to have the changed heart to go along with it. And there's so many ways to get involved. CFE here, we have ways. Love Inc. has ways. We have CareNet getting involved there. We have ways of getting involved and seeing lives changed and you be agents of